गुड इवनिंग। Good landscape behind Dr. Rajaraman and Arnab Banerjee.
Okay, sir, we are live. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to today's masterclass. It is the 13th in the series. Topic for today is rectal cancer. We have a series of eminent examiners with us today. We have Dr. KVV and Raju sir from our institute here at Basutargam, Hyderabad. He's joined by Dr. Chandramohan sir from Thiruvananthapuram. And with them, we have Colonel Arnab Banerjee sir from Kolkata. They are all joined by today's presenter, Dr. Parth from Saroj Gupta Cancer Institute, Kolkata. Before we go to the welcome address, I just want to share with all the participants who are here that all our previous masterclasses are on YouTube. You just have to search ISO webinars. The page is under the handle of ISO webinars and you'll find all the previous masterclasses there as well. Over to you, Arnab sir, for today's welcome address.
Thank you, Srijan. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to session 13 of PG Masterclass. It's amazing how time flies. You know, during the pandemic, there had been few good things apart from many bad things, obviously. So I think ISO has been doing a lot of academic activities. And we thought about, you know, involving the postgraduates as well. So that was the whole idea of having the PG Masterclasses. And I'm quite happy to see that we have done 12 already, which covers most of the important aspects of, you know, this exam. And we had been having
You lost him?
Yeah.
Can you hear us? Hear me?
Yes, sir.
Right. Yeah, so this rectal cancer obviously has got a lot of, you know, areas which need to be discussed. I'm sure Parth is going to do well. We had done some mock exams before this presentation. And the local mentor is Dr. Arnab Banerjee, my namesake from Common Hospital in Kolkata itself. And we have, apart from Arnab Banerjee, Dr. KVN Raju from Indo-American, and Dr. Chandramohan.
You're muted, sir.
Yeah, there was a telephone call. I've just canceled that. So only request to all the participants that please become a member of ISO. I just discovered that Parth was actually not a member. So I felt really bad that my PG is still not a member. So he obviously got membership done yesterday. So all the people who are participating, please become members of ISO. There's a lot to offer to all of you, both virtually and physically. And I'm sure, you know, once you become a member, there's a lot you can actually, you know, share. A lot of knowledge exchanges and a lot of fellowships that are there in the pipeline. It's already there actually existing, and there will be many more in the pipeline. So without wasting any more time, I would request Dr. Srijan and Dr. Subramaneshwar Rao, who is the convener for this academic council. And we know that we got four very dynamic past presidents. I just quickly name them: Dr. Kiran Kothari from West, Dr. Sarangi from East, Dr. Arun Chaturvedi from North, and Dr. Rajaraman from South. So they had actually been doing a lot of hard work to make master classes for ISO successful. I'm really grateful for all of you. Thank you very much. So have a wonderful time. I'm sure you're going to enjoy this PG Masterclass today as well.
Thank you, Arnab, sir. Before we start today's session, the common instructions which we give out before every session to the presenting candidate, we request you to give to the point answers. No candidate is ever expected to know all the answers. There's no harm in mentioning that you don't know one. It saves us time and it maintains the flow of this webinar. Our examiners have always been giving hints. It's up to you to catch one. And we request you to keep an open mind and not be too narrowed down to your diagnosis. For our dear examiners, in interest of online viewers, we please request you to give the expected answers to the questions that remain unanswered or have been incorrectly answered. And we also request you to go through the online chat as many candidates post their answers as well as queries, which is related to the ongoing discussion. Regarding the timekeeping, the case discussion will be allotted 1 hour time. I'll be giving a physical ring at 30 minutes and giving two rings at the conclusion of the case discussion. Without wasting any more further time, I request our examiners, Dr. K.B. Vin Raju sir, Chandra Mohan sir, and Arnab sir, to take hold of the proceedings. Thank you.
Dr. Parth, I would like to request sir, Chandra Mohan sir, and Raju sir, can we start?
Yeah, please start. I think we are waiting for that.
Yeah. So, Parth, please start.
Yes, sir. Sir, my screen is visible there?
It's visible.
Good evening, respected teachers.
Your screen is not visible.
Share your screen.
Your screen is not visible. Please use the share screen and...
Okay, sir.
Not yet, Partha. Any problems?
Sir, I'm unable to go back to the Zoom.
You've opened the presentation? Presentation is open?
Yes, sir. I have opened the presentation.
Yeah. Okay. Just go down into the Zoom app.
So I can guide him through.
Yeah. Yes.
My Zoom app is already open, but
can you see the share button, share screen button part? You did this once before, just 5 minutes.
Yeah, I did it once.
Green button.
Yeah. Don't panic. No problem.
Yeah. It's okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Great. Just relax. It's fine. You can start from the beginning.
Good evening, respected teachers. So a 34-year-old lady, homemaker, resident of Bangladesh, presented to the OPD with the chief complaints of bleeding per rectum for past 6 months. History of present illness. She noticed bleeding per rectum for 6 months before. It was insidious in onset and painless. It was a fresh red in color, small in amount, and it was not mixed with the stool and smearing the surface of the stool, and it was associated with the non-purulent offensive mucus discharge while defecation. She also been complaining of change in the bowel habit for past 2 months. She tends to pass stool, formed stool 5 to 6 times a day, alternating with the not passing stool for 1 to 2 days, and it is associated with the constant desire to defecate and feeling of incomplete evacuation. She also gives a history of anorexia and associated weight loss of 5 kg in last 6 months. There is no history of fecal incontinence, constipation, obstipation or abdominal pain or distension, melena, rectal or perianal fullness, urinary complaints, vaginal fullness, bleeding or discharge, backache. There is no history of bloody diarrhea, abdominal cramping or passes of excessive mucus discharge. There is no history of the fever, yellowish discoloration of sclera, pedal edema, chronic cough, dyspnea, hemoptysis or altered sensorium. There is no past, coming to the past history, there is no past history of similar complaints or any surgical interventions or any malignancies in the past. There is a history of homeopathic treatment being received for her illness. Coming to the personal history, she is a non-vegetarian and she doesn't consume tobacco, alcohol or smoking, and sleep pattern is normal and she doesn't have any comorbidity. Coming to the obstetric and menstrual history, she has two living children. Both children delivered normally vaginally. Last menstrual period is 14th of April this year, and she bleeds regularly 4 to 5 days after every 28 days without any undue pain or prolongation, and it is painless. Family.
Parth, go a little one slide before.
Yes.
When we talk about one, no, this is all right. When we talk about bleeding, if we can put it like a doctor, if the menstrual cycle, the bleeds for 4 to 5 days, what is the duration? Rather than putting it in this way, I would rather would like to hear it from you like a doctor. What is the cycle duration? What is the cycle frequency and all these things? This will probably hear it in a better way. Number one. Number two, if there is no consuming of tobacco, you can put it in not that this way, patient doesn't consume any tobacco. Is there, if she is not consuming tobacco, is there any way of putting a cigarette? Any tobacco product makes it a comprehensive way of putting it. Tobacco or alcohol.
Okay.
And one step, one slide before, go back. Why have you taken a urinary complaint of increased frequency? I want to know that.
Sir, since she presented with a bleeding per rectum, so keeping in mind the differential diagnosis and ruling it out, in case of any loco-regional invasion by any rectal pathology, so I want to rule out urinary complaints.
In case of a loco-regional disease, will you get an increased frequency first or something else? Because if you put it in an increased frequency, in a general knowledge, I think about thinking about whether you want to rule out a urinary tract infection, which is most common in the this age group of a female. Or if there is a loco-regional disease, you want to say that it is it may be a colovesical fistula or a rectovesical fistula or rectourethral fistula, is it?
Sir, that could be irritation by any rectal pathology, which can lead to the increased frequency.
Right.
Dr. Parth, can you clarify what do you mean by that vaginal fullness?
Yes.
Sir, vaginal fullness, I mean that she doesn't complain of any vaginal mass or growth that she can feel of.
That you get in the history?
Sir, if in case of it is associated with vaginal mass growth or any prolapse, that she can give history that she has some feeling in the vagina.
Again, okay, go ahead. One thing, Dr. Parth, if a rectal growth or I'm just thinking it is a rectal or some lower rectal or a rectal growth, if it comes and has to erode a bladder of a this year old female, then there is one more organ which is sitting between rectum and the bladder, isn't it?
Yes, uterus.
So this has to, when it invades the bladder, the patient will not present with frequency, it will present with a frank fecalurea.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Shall I proceed?
Carry on.
Family history is non-contributive. So to summarize my history, a 34-year-old lady with painless bleeding per rectum for past 6 months, which is associated with change in the bowel habit, anorexia, and significant weight loss without feature suggestive of the fecourinary incontinence, obstruction, or distant metastasis.
Yes, Parth, what do you think the patient is having at this point?
Sir, by the history, we can make out that we are dealing with some rectal pathology, which is non-obstructive at present, and she doesn't have any features of distant metastasis as well.
And can you comment something regarding the location of the tumor from the history?
Yes, sir. The tumor is certainly located above the anorectal ring, or the it is not involving the sphincter, so it could be mid rectum or the upper rectum.
Why it is not involved in the sphincter?
Sir, because she doesn't complain of any fecal incontinence.
Do you think that incontinence of sphincter, the presentation is fecal incontinence? Suppose the patient had pain. It's painless bleeding. The patient is having pain. Does it signify something?
Sir, it is above the dentate line.
So, rectal cancer is above dentate line only. What is the definition of rectum?
The surgical or the operational definition, it is below the peritoneal reflection.
No, and it should be above dentate line. Below dentate line is something else. So, our discussion is about rectum and it should be above dentate line.
Yes.
Yeah, so when I'll tell you two scenarios. One patient is having a painful defecation, and another patient is having just a bleeding per rectum without a painful defecation. So can you guess the location of the tumor in each case?
Sir,
two patients, one patient has a painless bleeding per rectum, and second patient is having a painful defecation and tenesmus, etc. So can you comment on the location of the tumor?
Sir, the former one scenario could be the mid rectum or the above rectum, and the
you're correct, and second one should be lower rectum.
Second one should be the lower rectum. Which
why?
Sir, because it is certainly below the dentate line, so the mucosa below the dentate line is painful.
Yeah, it shouldn't be below. It shouldn't be below the lower anorectal area. Is there are sensitive receptors, so it should be painful.
Yes.
Okay. Good. Go ahead.
There is a question from Dr. Madhu Murali, sir, and I would have also asked you that family history should have been a bit more elaborate, particularly when it's a 34-year-old rectal cancer. Can you, what kind of a family history you have taken, and what a significance?
Yes.
Of that.
So I asked about any first or second generation degree relative from maternal or paternal side have ever been affected with any malignancy in the past, and it is non-contributive.
If a person has got this lady says my father had a thyroid cancer, would have been, you told any cancer, is it any cancer or would be something which are more important in colonic or rectal? If
yes,
a patient,
sir,
says my mother has got a thyroid cancer or a Gallagher cancer or a oral cancer, would it have been the same?
No, sir. Lynch cancer, any association with the HNPCC related tumor, or FAP, familial adenomatous polyposis, or any polyposis coli.
What are HNPCC associated cancer which is non-rectal? Can you name?
Sir, the extracolonic malignancies in HNPCC that include...
In a lady...
The extracolonic malignancies in HNPCC that includes endometrial cancer, hepatobiliary pancreatic cancer, renal pelvis, ureter, urinary bladder.
Brain, stomach, small intestine. No.
Yes, sir. Any GI, HPB, endometrial, renal pelvis, ureter, urinary bladder.
We used to remember like that. Bose is a famous
Bose
music system, BOSE. B stands for all the biliary tract and brain.
Yes.
So O stands for ovarian upper endometrium, and A stands for stomach, small intestine, and E is, of course, endometrium. Carry on.
So, doctor, one more question. Has the patient, is the patient, is any runs any family, his, any familial cancer risk from the history?
Sir, she doesn't fall into any risk category.
Why?
because the first, second or third generation from maternal or paternal side are not been affected with any malignancies.
Suppose the patient or the biopsy report is showing that MSI histology.
She can be a proband also. She can be the first.
Yes.
Other way around, at this point of discussion, you should be knowing which are the high-risk features. For example, Amsterdam criteria or Bethesda criteria. So even with a single patient, you can have a familial risk, have a familial risk and suspicion for HNBCC.
Yes,
so,
sir.
Which is the scenario?
Yes, sir.
Which is that scenario? I answered. I gave you a hint in my question.
Sir, can you just repeat one more time, please?
Which is the scenario where a single patient, the patient with the, this patient, can run a family a risk of familial cancer? If you know the Bethesda criteria, no. You know the answer.
Bethesda criteria, I'm not recollecting right now.
Okay. You should have, you have to, because examiner has asked that. So what I'm going to tell that, if this patient, if it is less than 50, and if there is MSI criteria also, she runs very high risk of familial breast cancer in, according to HNPCC. And one more thing, in now the most centers, irrespective of the age, all patients, they screen for HNPCC.
Yes,
but this patient,
yes,
definitely if it is MSI positive. Otherwise, she should have two first degree relatives, or she should have a history of colonic cancer in the past.
Yes.
So these are the things which are positive in Bethesda criteria, which necessitates a genetic testing.
Dr. Path, because she is less than 50 years, we have to be extremely careful in eliciting the family history to establish that she doesn't have any disease. Go ahead.
Yes.
Go ahead.
All right.
Coming to the general examination, I have examined the patient after taking consent in the presence of a nursing attendant in an adequate well-lit room. She is a conscious, alert and well-oriented to time, place and person. The performance status in the Eastern Cooperative Oncology Group is 1, and his height is 155 centimeter, weight is 52 and BMI is 22.6 kilogram per meter square. Vitals are stable. Pulse rate is 72 beats per minute over the right radial artery. Blood pressure is 120/70 over the right brachial artery in the supine position. Respiratory rate is 16 beats per minute. Pallor is present and there is no icterus, pedal edema, generalized or generalized lymphadenopathy. Coming to the parabdominal examination, the abdomen is flat. Umbilicus is centrally placed and non-everted. All the quadrants are moving equally with the respiration. No flank or renal angles fullness. No visible scar. Peristalsis, prominent or engaged vein, sinuses. Hernial sites are normal. The abdomen is on superficial palpation. It is non-tender to touch and there is no organomegaly or ascites. No inguinal lymphadenopathy noted and bowel sounds present. Coming to the digital rectal examination, I have explained the position. I have explained the patient regarding position and the procedure. Patient being in the left lateral position with the knees being flexed. And on inserting the lubricated glove finger, on parting the buttock, the perineal skin doesn't show any scar mark, sinus fistula, fissure or skin tag. And on inserting the lubricated glove finger, the anal tone is felt adequate. There is an ulceroproliferative mass being felt 5 cm from anal verge in the posterior rectal wall from 7 to 10 o'clock position. It is firm in consistency. It is tender to touch, irregular surface, ill-defined margin, mobility is restricted, and it occupies more than half of the circumference of the bowel wall lumen, and the upper extent could not be reached. When we examined the glove finger after taking it out, it revealed blood stain with the mucus. There was no pelvic deposit felt in the rectouterine pouch and rest of the anorectal mucosa is normal. The proctoscopy could not be done since it was it caused discomfort to the patient. Coming to the parvagina.
Just a minute, Parth. Yes. Go back. You have told that you have felt a mass 5 cm and you have seen also from the rectal examination that it is occupying the. If what kind of a discomfort which could not you could not push a proctoscopy.
Sir, while doing examination in the OPD, the patient was quite apprehensive. So, and it was very, so that's why she didn't allow the proctoscopy.
Right, right.
Okay, go ahead.
Coming to the per vaginam examination, the per speculum examination didn't reveal any mass growth, bleeding, discharge or irregularity of the vaginal mucosa, which was again confirmed on the per vaginal examination. So to summarize my case, a 34-year-old lady, performance status ECOG 1 presented with history of bleeding per rectum for past 6 months, which was associated with change in the bowel habit and tenesmus, anorexia and significant weight loss without any comorbidity. She has pallor and an ulceroproliferative rectal growth of malignant nature being felt 5 cm from anal verge without any features suggestive of obstruction, sphincter involvement, inguinal lymphadenopathy or features suggestive of distant metastasis.
So, how did you rule out the sphincter involvement?
Sir, the patient doesn't complain of any fecal incontinence.
And anything in the examination? Examination was fixed almost. What is your examination finding?
Examination finding, the ulceroproliferative growth was 5 cm from the anal verge.
Okay.
You said there is restricted mobility.
Restricted mobility.
Yes, sir.
And you said sphincter is free. How are you, how these are tallying?
Sir, the mobility of mass was restricted in relation to the rectal wall, posterior rectal wall particularly.
Can you know, do you know, although it is not been used, it has been, it was been using long ago. Is there any scoring system of knowing whether the rectal mass and its fixity? Do you know any scoring system? It used to be used earlier, but
yes,
these days...
it was used in earlier Masson. I'm forgetting the name.
It's Yoke-Masson staging system, wherein
yes,
they can assess the mobility and then you categorize, grade them. So the highest would be the fixed one, intermediate, and then the completely mobile. And
yes,
the other important point you need to mention is, because there is restricted mobility, how do you say the sphincter is not involved? And I think you did comment about the tone.
Sir,
and sphincter tone. I think
he mentioned.
Okay.
Right,
sir,
okay.
Anal tone is adequate.
Okay, you mentioned it. Go ahead. Now, how do you say that there is no sphincter involvement?
Points to favor in the history that she doesn't give any history of the fecal incontinence. Points to favor from the examination that the anal tone is adequate and the tumor is felt just above the anal ring.
So you see, there is a difficulty because the sphincter, the incontinence depends upon several factors, whether it's the internal sphincter, the external sphincter is involved or not. If the external sphincter is spared, he may not have incontinence, even though if the internal sphincter is involved.
Yes.
So you cannot be so categorical that there is no sphincter involvement.
Okay.
Part of the essential and Achilles heel of lower rectal cancer management is knowing and managing the sphincter involvement. And actually, your tumor is almost located at the area of the sphincter. And if you casually mention this, it is not going to be pardoned. And there, in fact, so many people have put so much effort in identifying the sphincter involvement. If you look at the Mercury trial, Mercury 2 trial, and a lot of effort has been put. And if I were you, I will never dare to comment that this sphincter is free. So sphincter involvement has to be assessed. The sphincter is not involved to the extent of it making it dysfunctional. That doesn't mean that sphincter is not involved. Even if it is touching, it is involved. And in a fixed growth, you should be worried about the sphincter involvement before casually making a comment during your clinical examination.
Okay, sir.
Yes, please go ahead. Anything else you like to see? So I have seen there is no peritoneal deposits and the disease you described. Anything else you like to see at by paracal examination? Anything extra luminal you like to feel?
No, sir.
So what is, other than local tumor involvement, what is more important in local regional spread?
Whether the tumor can be felt bimanually by inserting the...
No. You try. No, I'll give you the answer. You try to see any lymph nodes are involved. Because yes, sometimes you may be able to pick up the lymph node enlargement extraluminally.
Okay.
And one more question. If apart from sphincter involvement, what do you think? It is a early rectal cancer or a locally advanced rectal cancer?
Locally advanced rectal cancer.
Fine. Then sphincter should be involved. Go ahead.
Sir, the rest of the systemic examination were within normal limit. Coming to the provisional diagnosis, carcinoma rectum without obstruction and features suggestive of distant metastasis in a 34-year-old lady without any comorbidity.
I need to answer.
Would you proceed further?
Sir, I will confirm my diagnosis and I will stage the disease and simultaneously also I will do the test for the general fitness.
So do you have any differential diagnoses?
No, sir.
You by carcinoma rectum, you are meaning that it is adenocarcinoma or?
Yes, sir.
The can it be neuroendocrine cancer?
Sir, it can be, sir, neuroendocrine tumor, but the most common pathology is the adenocarcinoma.
Yeah, no, it cannot be neuroendocrine carcinoma because number one, neuroendocrine carcinoma is rare. Number two, neuroendocrine carcinoma don't advance like this. It will be always very small, and even if the metastasis throws up.
Yes, so and usually it is associated with pain, neuroendocrine tumors.
Need not be, but neuroendocrine carcinoma won't grow to this extent.
Yes, sir.
Please go ahead. How do you investigate this patient?
So, sir, I will do the test to confirm my diagnosis, to stage the disease and to test to do the general fitness. So, we have done the full length colonoscopy for this patient. Yes, and
sorry to interrupt you. You are getting a mass at 5 cm from anal bulge, right?
Yes, sir.
The first thing, you are doing a colonoscopy. Why can't you do a proctoscopy and take a punch biopsy? I would rather do the colonoscopy for a whole colon assessment.
Sir, why certainly...
Wait for 5 or 2 days and to prepare the patient and then send for colonoscopy, which the biopsy will take another 5 days.
Certainly, sir. We can do the proctoscopy and take the biopsy. But we need to do the colonoscopy to assess the full colon in order to avoid detect any synchronous lesions.
Yes, that is a part of the protocol, for the workup protocol. To get a diagnosis, it is just a 5 minutes job, which is office procedure.
I think the patient didn't allow that, what he mentioned. Proctoscopy.
Yes.
Proctoscopy, yes.
You have to do you can do it in a proctoscopy and take a punch biopsy. Finish.
Yes, sir. We can certainly do that.
Yes. Carry on.
So, sir, this is the colonoscopy report, which revealed the same finding that the ulceroproliferative growth 5 cm from the anal verge, and it was kindly annulostricturing type of growth, and the scope could not be negotiated further. So, we had just taken out multiple biopsy. And it turned out to be adenocarcinoma on the histopathology report. So after completing biopsy workup, I would like to go for the staging workup, which includes the loco-regional staging as well as distant staging.
Arthur, just an interruption. You said in your examination findings, it is a growth in the posterior rectal wall between the 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock position only. But your endoscopist is unable to negotiate. That doesn't mean there is an obstruction there. Could be a technical problem there.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes.
So was a complete colonoscopy was carried out in this patient or not?
No, sir. Could not be done.
Okay. But we expect that we should be able to carry out a complete colonoscopy.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Unless you are wrong in describing it. It is circumferential, it's okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, this is not matching.
Okay, go ahead. So what is next?
So for the local regional staging, sir, we have done the MRI pelvis, which revealed the tumor, which is arising from the 5.2 centimeter from the anal verge, involving the mesorectum. There was mesorectal and the perirectal nodes as well, and the extent of the growth proximally around up to 6 to 7 centimeter, without any inguinal or any other lymphadenopathy, without involvement of the surrounding structures as well.
So, Parth, when did you do an MRI scan? Why can't you do a CT scan?
Sir, MRI is for any pelvic pathology, MRI is superior to CT scan.
Hmm. Now, what is so special in rectum? Forget about other pelvic pathologies.
Sir, we want to know the mesorectal fascia and the circumferential resection margin, peritoneal reflection, and we want. So this this soft tissue delineation is better by MRI than CT scan.
Come again. You told circumferential resection margin and peritoneal reflection. Come again. What did you do?
Sir, MRI is.
Repeat. What did you tell?
Yes, MRI can certainly tell about the mesorectum involvement or the mesorectal fascia, circumferential resection margin, and any nodes in the pararectal or the mesorectal fat, peritoneal, the deposition or the position of the peritoneal reflection, and soft tissue delineation. So these all entities are superior in MRI rather than CT scan.
Anything else?
Yeah. At 5 centimeter, are you worried about something else?
Sir, sphincter involvement can be commented upon on MRI.
In this location, that is the most important what we are looking at. Anything else?
Any?
As a surgeon, you will be interested in.
Sir, the extent, local extent of the tumor anteriorly or posteriorly, involvement of the denovellus fascia, or whether it is breaching the denovellus fascia, or posteriorly whether it is breaching the valdus.
Anything else? What is the word for that?
Locoregionally advanced.
No, no. What you look for is called circumferential radial CRM margin. Circumferential radial margin.
Yes, sir.
That has to be commented on the MRI.
Yes, sir. Circumferential radial margin.
So we need to understand the relationship of the tumor to the mesorectal fascia. And based on that, you will say the, whether the CRM is involved or not involved, or whether it is threatened. Because yes, that is making, that would be a decision maker for us.
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
So, sir, the distant metastasis, including the CCT chest and abdomen, which turn out to be within normal limits.
So why do you do a CCT chest?
Sir, to rule out distant metastasis.
Okay. Do you distant metastasis where?
Distant metastasis to lung, liver.
No, no. I'm talking about contrast enhanced CT scan of the chest is what you mentioned. Why do you require a contrast enhancement for the CT evaluation of the chest?
Sir, it can be done without contrast as well, but the to look for the any lung or any mediastinal window, that can be better enhanced on giving contrast.
Where do you want to see lung? Where do you want to see lung? That's the question.
Yes, sir. I want to see the parenchyma is better enhanced on giving contrast.
No, no. Why? No, we are not discussing contrast versus not contrast. Why do you want to see lung? Where do you want to do CT chest?
Sir, sir, in case of locally, since I am suspecting this a case to be a locally advanced rectal cancer, so there are 10 to 15% chances of the distant metastasis. That's why.
So I am asking which are the cancers which throws metastasis at lung and why? In rectum, various locations.
Sir, I mean the pathway could be, it could be via the portal vein, go to the liver, and then a tertiary spread to the lung, or
it's very unlikely, na? It will go to liver, will filter it out. How does it reach lung?
Sir, there is another pathway that any tumor emboli may get lodged into the inferior vena cava, and directly bypassing the liver, it can go to lung.
How does it reach inferior vena cava?
The drainage, venous drainage of the rectum is usually the superior and the middle hemorrhoidal vein. But in case of there is some bypass channel which can.
See, I'll tell you the answer. It's not bypass channel. In lower rectal cancers, the venous drainage is to the systemic side, not among the portal side. The venous drainage goes to the pudendal and goes up to the systemic side. From there, lung metastasis is likely. Yes. From the upper rectal tumors, it goes to the portal system. So, since this being a low rectal cancers, so the chance of lung metastasis is more. But if you again look into Western guidelines, they are recommending CT chest, but ICMR guideline is recommending only X-ray chest.
X-ray chest.
That also you have to please understand. But again, this being a low rectal cancer, there is more chance of lung metastasis, and even more, it is little advanced. So, you are all justified in doing a CT scan chest.
Yes, sir.
Are there a few corrections? You said the incidence of lung metastasis is about 10 to 15%. It's not that high. It's around 3 to 8%. Second, for evaluation of the lung, a plain CT is good enough. But because you are doing a contrast enhanced CT abdomen, most of the time in the same sitting, you will be doing the chest also. So therefore, it is one investigation only. But if you are asked to, is there any advantage of contrast enhancement for evaluating the lung? There is none. For metastatic point of view. If you are evaluating the mediastinum, there is some role to play.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Any other investigation you will carry out?
Sir, apart from this routine imaging workup, I would definitely go for the test for the general fitness, including the tumor marker, CEA.
So what's the relevance of CEA? Where do you want to do CEA?
Sir, to know the baseline value of the CEA, because CEA is a poor prognostic. CEA is a poor prognostic factor for, and it indicates the advanced disease.
So, no, you are both sentences. CEA, is it a good prognostic marker?
If the values are increased, then it's a poor prognostic marker.
So, you have one patient with the CA 6 and another patient with CA 4. Is there a difference in prognosis?
No, sir.
So, it becomes prognostic only it is very high.
Very high.
Otherwise, it just used for follow-up.
Yes, sir.
And yes, some of the rectal tumors are non-CEA secretors. So, yes, you may not get a CEA high, but quite advanced cancer. But you have to know the CEA, because in post-op patients, well, if the CA is increased, then that should bring something.
Yes, sir.
Okay. How do you manage this patient? Is there anything? What is the plan, protocol?
Sir, I will admit the patient for the all this general fitness test, and at the same time, simultaneously, I would resuscitate by giving blood since she is having pallor, and after that, having contemplated this. Case in the multidisciplinary tumor board, I would go for the further definitive treatment.
So, what's the definitive treatment you are suggesting as a member of MDT?
Sir, I would go for the long course chemo radiation followed by reassessment.
Why? Why can't you do upfront surgery?
Sir, this tumor is probably the, I mean, it is a T3 tumor, a locally advanced tumor, a T3 N0 M0 tumor. So, by giving a neoadjuvant therapy in the form of chemo radiation, that reduces the local recurrence up to 6% when the historical or recurrence was 25 to 30%, but with the effect of the neoadjuvant therapy, it has brought down to 6%.
Are you expecting an increased survival after neoadjuvant treatment?
Sir, the achieving neoadjuvant therapy can achieve PCR and downsize the tumor. So, it may translate into the DFS, disease-free survival and overall survival.
Has it translated? Is there any evidence?
Sir, the German cancer rectal group trial which has, I mean, the secondary outcomes of that trial that shows that on a longer run, 5 years after, the PCR was translated into overall survival benefit.
When you forget about PCR, I'm asking you, a patient, a septal patient getting upfront surgery, septal patient getting long course CTRT upfront. So is there any survival difference according to German trial?
No, sir.
So then what are the other advantages of other than local recurrence? Other than local recurrence, you mentioned. What are other advantages?
Sir, it may reduce the chances of the distant metastasis as well, and cancer-related mortality also can be prevented.
It hasn't, no? The trial, it hasn't. What's other advantage? What are the changes? You mentioned German trial. You only mentioned German trial.
Yes.
What's the advantage they found out in German trial?
It may downsize the tumor to enhance the chance of the sphincter preservation.
Yeah, sphincter preservation was easier and more. It became more. So, is there any other type of modality you like to use? Would you like to use short course?
Sir, definitely we can go for short
today,
course.
Nowadays it's called COVID also, it's because the patient needs to come for around month. So, short course.
Definitely, sir, we can go for short course radiotherapy as well. But it depends upon the institutional policy that.
No, if you are given freedom to choose both, short course as well as long course, which one will you choose?
Sir, I will go for the long course chemo radiation.
Why? Is there any recent trial which has long course is better?
Sir, the recent Stockholm 3 trial, which used short course radiotherapy, that shows the superior benefit of short course chemo radiation followed by delayed surgery. It is still not prospectively evaluated and validated. So as of now, in a country like India, it depends upon the institutional protocol what you follow. So that's why.
You know, would you advise short course radiation for a locally advanced rectal cancer? Very simple question.
Sir, we can advise.
Now, how do you decide between the short course versus, this is a distal rectal cancer. It is affecting the sphincters. So likely to be CRM is likely to be positive. So how are you going to decide between short course versus a long course?
Sir, usually the T3B onwards tumor on the MRI, usually they get benefits from the long course chemo radiation. And T3A tumor, since they have less local recurrence than T3B onwards tumor, so short course radiation is given to T3A tumor.
So why the long course gives benefits?
Sir, because chemotherapy, adding chemotherapy to the radiation, that improves the disease-free survival. Whether we can give in a neoadjuvant setting or in a adjuvant setting, adding chemotherapy, that increases the DFS.
Now, you need to consider the most important is you want to downstage the disease here.
Yes.
And you want to have an R0 resection. So if you want to downstage the disease or to achieve an R0 resection, the better option would be a long course chemo radiation treatment, or the second protocol would be a short course treatment with adjuvant chemotherapy and delay your surgery. In our country, by and large, we are following the long course treatment, but the other option would be a short course with adjuvant with chemotherapy with the delayed surgery.
Yes, sir.
So you should tell, we want to downstage the disease. For downstaging, a better modality would be a long course radiation with chemotherapy. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, in fact, they tried in Polish trial, the Polish 2 trial, they tried to see whether short course is advantageous, and they found out it's not superior. So,
yes, sir.
At present, locally advanced, you should go for a long course, that is as a practical tip.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And which are the drugs and how it is planned, long course, chemo, radiation?
I will go for the capecitabine concurrent chemo radiation.
Why capecitabine? Why not 5-fluorouracil?
Sir, capecitabine is superior to infusional 5-fluorouracil is been proven, and capecitabine is an oral form of 5-fluorouracil. So, and the equivalence, biological equivalence, is same. So
it's same, not superior, and the logistic is better.
Logistically, it is better.
Logistically, it is
better. Not superior, or better. Okay, fine. So, how? What? Any? You do know anything about the duration or something? It's okay if you don't know also.
Sir,
how long is given? How much? What's the strength of the tablet?
Yeah, yeah. The capecitabine 825 milligram per meter square divided into 2 or 3 doses that can be given all the day of the radiation. And the dose of the radiation is usually 50 or 50.4 gray in 25 to 28 fractions for 5 to 6 weeks.
Okay. So once you complete this treatment, what is next?
So, sir, I will go for the long course chemo radiation consisting of the capecitabine.
No, you did it. This treatment is complete. So what is next?
Okay. So, sir, after completing the neoadjuvant therapy, I would reassess with the local staging and the distance.
When?
After 6 to 8 weeks, I would do the local imaging and the distant imaging to look for the response. In the local imaging, I would go for the, again, with the same imaging that I have used previously.
So, is why 6 weeks? Why not 10 weeks?
Sir, it has been shown that waiting beyond more than 8 weeks, the benefit is same, whether you wait up to 8 weeks or there is no further advantage on waiting more than 8 weeks.
If you delay further, any disadvantage?
Yes, sir. The disadvantage could be there would be more pelvic fibrosis due to radiation.
Anything else?
Chances of the anastomotic stricture and the leak dehiscence would be higher.
Oh, that you are going to remove anyway. Oncological, anything different?
Sir, the tumor may, the tumor emboli may get lodged and cause distant metastasis.
No, it is not tumor emboli. There is a repopulation of the cancer cells. If you delay it beyond a certain limit, there is likely to be repopulation, which will make it a worse outcomes.
Yes, sir.
If you operate very early, what happens?
Very early operate, it increases the chance of leak.
Why there will be leak?
Look, if I want to do an APR, then there is no chances of leak. Say, not in this patient, if I want to do an APR, there is no chances of leak. And number two, for instance, if you after 6 weeks, you do a PR, there is no growth. Although in this case, it will not be. So would you like to operate? And in which situation you might not like to operate if there is any trial?
Sir, I would still want to go for surgery. Even if it is the growth is not felt on digital rectal examination.
Yes. What does it mean if you have not got anything? That means the patient has responded well to neoadjuvant therapy. It also talks about the biology of the disease. That yes. Your innate biology of the disease is good. Disease is responding, and that automatically translates into disease-free survival and overall survival when there is, although they say pathological complete response. Not in this case of locally advanced CA rectum, but of course T1, T2 disease, if you can get a pathological complete response, then it is good for the patient and for you also.
Yes.
So how are you going to evaluate this patient for surgery?
Okay, so sir, after 6 to 8 weeks, again, on I will do the clinical examination and the local imaging as well as the distant imaging and the tumor marker study. And I will look for the downsizing of the tumor. And
Partha, why do you want to do the distant imaging and why do you want to do the imaging of the local area?
Like if you have seen that the disease has downgraded, you are not finding a disease that much in your PR. What was the, also the question from Dr. Madhumurli, sir, that if the, you, do you need to do a distant imaging again?
Sir, in case of locally advanced CA, if you are with the delayed surgery, the chances of the interval metastasis are up to 5%. So we need to, for that reason, we need to do the distant imaging. And to answer the Raju sir's question, that the local imaging, because to know the tumor response, if the tumor has not responded to the neoadjuvant treatment, then I may have to further reconsideration of the adding further neoadjuvant treatment in the form of chemotherapy as well.
Now I
considering the tumor is not responding.
I ask you one question. In this MRI, was the CRM threatened?
Yes, sir.
Theorem was said, and there was notes. So you will never get a clear margin. That's why you are put. Now, if there is no reduction in the disease after neoadjuvant therapy, so would you not operate and give chemotherapy and wait?
Sir, in that case, I would go for the neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
So, neoadjuvant CCRT plus neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
Yes, sir. If the disease is not responding to the chemo radiation.
Does it...
Is it better chemotherapy before radiation or chemotherapy after radiation?
Does any trial says that? Or you are putting any trial or anywhere it has been followed that neoadjuvant chemo radiotherapy, the patient has not gone, we give chemotherapy.
Sir, we can, like, total neoadjuvant therapy, we can implement that concept into this locally advanced rectal cancer, that we can use all sorts of treatment before going for surgery in order to downsize the tumor to achieve the PCR. And better to achieve circumferential resection margin clear.
Also, do you know any trials recently being?
Sir, for total neoadjuvant?
Neoadjuvant, yeah.
Sir, I don't... I it's know good. The... But I don't know the name.
Have you heard of Rapido trial?
Yeah. Oh, yes, sir.
So, what's the result? What's the outcome?
Yes, sir. So, it said, sir, that... total neoadjuvant chemotherapy, in case where there are bulky nodes, the CRM or the mesorectum is involved, T3 onwards tumor, using total neoadjuvant therapy before surgery, that certainly achieves the PCR and achieves clear CRM.
Any survival advantages?
No, sir. Up to now, there is no survival benefits in. Only local recurrence is reduced.
Local recurrence, fine.
Pardo, you are looking for a response to the treatment. Your aim is not to achieve PCR. If you achieve PCR, it's good for the patient.
Yes.
Okay. So don't get, aim is not PCR.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, what next? So I'll tell you that it just downstaged in your MRI scan. Okay. And patient wants a sphincter preservation.
Okay, sir. So, if the then I will go for the exploratory laparotomy with a curative intent in the form of low anterior resection.
No, okay. Man, you have to decide, man. How do you decide? You can't ask whatever patients, do whatever patient asks. So, how do you decide sphincter preservation is feasible?
Sir, I will look for the anorectal ring involvement on the MRI imaging.
Okay.
Whether and the distance of the tumor from that anorectal ring, that considering that the radial circumferential radial margin, if it is more than 2 mm, then definitely we can go for this sphincter preserving surgery.
So at this location, what are you seeing? What are you looking? It's a TME involvement or muscle involvement? Where are you looking for the CRM? Is it at the...
I'm looking for anorectal ring, lower
ring. Okay.
Lower ring.
And how do you say that? How do you assess it? Do you know any clinical trial which specifically looked in this area? MRI scan?
Mercury 2 trial.
How do you know that this is safe? You can do a safe sphincter preservation.
Sir, how do we know? Sorry, sir.
How do you know you can do a safe sphincter preservation?
Okay. So, sir, if the tumor is more than 2 mm away from the lower border of the circumferential radial margin of the anorectal ring in case of lower rectal tumor, we can certainly achieve 1 centimeter of the distal negative margin by doing sphincter preserving surgery.
See, how do you know? Because it's not very easy as you think. If you look at the post-RT rectum, there may be fibrosis. And it may not be showing clearly tumor shrinking away. And it may be vague. So how do you know that whether there is fibrosis or tumor? By using an MRI. That is another unique advantage of MRI.
Sir, diffusion-weighted MRI is usually done for response assessment.
Okay.
So if the tumor
How does it look like?
Yes, sir. If the tumor has responded well because of the fibrosis, so that allows more diffusion of the signals, allowing the restriction of the signals. So the responded tumor will be hypodense, and the non-responded tumor will be hyperintense as usual.
So diffusion-weighted image, it is hypodense.
Responded tumors will be hypodense.
Partho, as of now, we cannot use a functional imaging for our clinical decision making. The reason is they have serious lacunae. It is very difficult to analyze the data. So as of now, it is only to predict the response, which will indicate the survival outcomes. It doesn't change your surgical methodology. The final decision is made on the histopathology alone.
Okay, sir.
So Partha, where are you, like sir said, Raju sir said, where are you deciding on the tumor response alone at this point? So you see, I'll tell you, I'll correct you. When you do a diffusion weighted images, it should be still gray. And if you do a white, it should be white. When you then, another method is ADC, absolute dissociation curve. And if you do that, suddenly it becomes black. So yes, that is suggestive malignancy. And if it is not there, even if it is not there, if you see fibrosis around, you won't dare to do a sphincter preservation. Why?
I don't know, sir.
Even if there is fibrosis at the sphincter, the tumor has gone. So what is the issue in doing a sphincter preservation?
No, sir. Then definitely we cannot do sphincter preserving surgery.
No, why? And you know, when you involve the partial involvement of the sphincter, which kind of sphincter preservation is done?
Intersphincteric resection can be offered.
Okay, what is the secret downside of intersphincteric resection?
What is the problems with IAC?
Sir, it may cause the positive CRM.
No, other than that.
More than that,
the patient will have the lifetime incontinence.
Yeah, so that is very, very severe issue. If you try to act in downstage and try to do, I just go into
the fecal incontinence.
Oncology will say, but otherwise patient will have issues. Patient will be defecating always.
Yes, sir. Yes. Patient will be defecating always.
So when you are doing sphincter preservation at the expense of quality of life.
Yes.
So please be careful when you just jump into doing things because patient wishes that, and patient will finally come back to you to change to a stoma bag.
Okay, sir.
Okay, go ahead. And would you like to change your management now?
I will go for the surgery with a curative intent in the form of low anterior resection with the coloanal anastomosis.
If this patient is 34 years old with MS, MR, aortic valve replacement, with a high cardiac risk, and you get a total response, you are not finding any growth. Would you like to wait and not operate?
Yes, sir. If the surgery is not possible because of comorbidities, then and the tumor, provided the tumor has responded well radiologically, then I would like to wait.
No, surgery is possible, but the risk is high. Surgery is possible. The risk is high. Would you undergo surgery or not?
I would involve some senior surgeon to.
That is the best.
No, it's not your surgical skill, man. It is the patient morbidity.
You are the most senior. You consider yourself as the most senior surgeon now. We all are juniors. Everybody around you is junior.
Sir, if the surgery is possible, then definitely surgery should be offered because it provides a survival benefit.
See, I'll tell to correct you because at this stage, now there is another modality is also practicing, which is observation. Non-operative management.
This is based on a Huber-Gamma trial.
Huber-Gamma
and I'll tell you when will you go wrong. The patient, you are doing an APR and the finally specimen as you expected is coming without no disease and patient dying post-operatively. Then the most courts in other countries will find you guilty because you have to tell the patient there's a chance of PCR and it has to be recorded and then only you should proceed with the surgery. If you... Medical legal, I think this may be important in our country as well. So at this point, the patient should be counseled and advised regarding the possibility of PCR, judging by the responses. And then she should be able to ask to take an informed decision whether to take the risk of surgery or not. You cannot thrust open, thrust the decision on from your side. So yes. This is very important.
Pat, yes. I have got one more question. Like you told this patient could not be, we could not do full colonoscopy prior to putting her on therapy, neoadjuvant therapy, because there was tight stricture. After the neoadjuvant therapy, the stricture has gone. Would you like to do a colonoscopy before taking her up for the surgery?
Yes, sir. We can go for the colonoscopy before taking up for the surgery.
If you can't do a colonoscopy, then when should you allow this patient to get a colonoscopy done?
Sir, maybe the initial colonoscopy could not be done. The reasons could be the technical failure or the more apprehensiveness of the patient. But since the patient is now more acquainted with the treatment plan, so maybe she is more responsive to the treatment protocol. So allowing colonoscopy to done after neoadjuvant.
And colonoscopy, in colonoscopy, what are you looking for?
Sir, I would look for any synchronous lesions in the colon.
If there is no synchronous lesion, you find two polyps in the right colon. Would you change your management or anything?
Sir, I will look for the size of the polyp whether and the nature of the polyp, whether it is pedunculated or sessile. And definitely, I will go for the biopsy. If in terms of polypectomy, if it is a small sizable lesion or if a big polyp is there, then definitely I would go for the biopsy.
Partha, suppose if you are doing APR, what will be your extent of surgery?
Sir, I will go for, after the mobilization of the entire left colon, the upper cut margin would be 5 cm from the upper border of the tumor and the lower margin till the anus. So,
why 5 cm? Where will you tie the vascular pedicle?
Sir, I will tie the inferior mesenteric artery. A low ligation is sufficient.
So, when will you do an LAP, extra levator accession?
Sir, yes, sir. Extra LAP is usually a procedure which in which we take out the entire cylinder and block removal of the specimen along with the mesorectum, ischiorectal fascia, levator.
When will you do in this particular case? When will you do it?
Sir, if the tumor is approaching to the lateral pelvic side wall or the ischiorectal fascia or the intersphincteric plane is involved.
The tumor is going to the lateral pelvic wall. So, what surgery will you do? Infiltrating lateral pelvic wall.
I would go for the ELAP.
No, it's impossible. It's ELAP for a sphincter involvement. If it is going lateral pelvic wall, it's no problem. which are lateral muscles?
Levator ani priest muscles of the
levator it's okay. If it goes to a lateral pelvic wall muscle, it is no problem. So don't do that. LAP is only when you suspect a sphincter involvement and is going laterally. Then what is the issue in doing LAP? What are the morbidity of LAP?
Sir, the perineal wound is a more issue. I mean, there will be a huge dead space in the perineum.
For that, so what you need to do?
We can close it primarily, or we can have.
LAP always calls for a reconstruction.
Always has to be reconstructed.
Yes.
And one more question, sir. When will you do a lateral pelvic wall dissection?
Lateral pelvic wall dissections are usually practiced in the Japan, but nowadays the trials are showing that if on the response imaging MRI, we are looking at the size of the node and the morphology of the node. If the size is more than 7 mm in the short axis, or the morphology is rounded etiology, regular border, bulky nodes in the lateral pelvic group of lymph node, then definitely we should go for the lateral lymph node dissection.
So when will you do inguinal node dissection?
After response assessment, if the nodes are there, then definitely we should go for the inguinal block dissection.
Yeah, especially for lower rectum cancer.
Lower rectum cancer.
Just one. The inguinal nodes, what would be the stage of the disease?
Yes.
Inguinal node, the stage of the disease is N1 disease. It is N plus disease. It is not M1 disease.
In a rectum.
Involvement of the external iliac makes it M1. Involvement of the...
Sir is specifically asking about inguinal lymph nodes.
Inguinal lymph nodes are then, sir, some of the, it is still not considered as M1 disease, because some of the blood supply and the lymphatics of the lower rectum that merges with the anus and go to the inguinal as well as iliac group of lymph node. So,
the inguinal nodes in rectal cancer will occur only in locally advanced cancers, when the external anal sphincter has been infiltrated, and most of them, they're not amenable for any surgical resection. The survival outcomes are dismal. So therefore, you should not be jump on to carry out inguinal block dissection at presentation. In a small subgroup of patients where you have got an excellent clinical response, there is a long-term disease-free survival, or when the patient comes to you later after the completion of treatment with isolated inguinal nodes, those are the group of patients you may carry out inguinal nodal dissection.
Yes.
That's a very selective group. One more thing, to add, probably we are overshooting the time. In a 34-year-old patient or a young patient, you should always give them a consideration for fertility preservation.
Yes.
Before embarking on such a big surgery, and you have to always think about that and talk to patient about that.
Yes, sir. Definitely.
So, Parth, before winding up, one more question. Would you do laparoscopy in this patient?
Sir, definitely yes. We can do laparoscopic resection. But since the trials are recent, trials are not encouraging that LAP is non-inferior to open surgeries, like as per the ALACAR trial or the ECOSOC trial. So, as of now, sir, and I would go for the open surgery.
What are the endpoints of the ALACAR trial? Because you alluded to that.
Sir, the ALACAR trial, it was shown that the oncological equivalence is as same as the open, but on a longer trend, after 2 years, there was a trend toward decrease in the survival and the disease-free survival as well.
The endpoints are basically the pathological endpoints, the circumferential resection margin. That is what they looked at it. Your survival outcomes are okay, but your more mature data is awaited.
Yes.
Okay. So I think for want of time, I think we have to stop it here. You did very well. We need to correct a few things, but your performance is quite good.
Yes, it's a good performance.
Thank you, Dr. Parth. Dr. Raju sir, can you please load up your presentation? And while he does so, I request comments from Dr. Chandramohan sir and Dr. Arnab sir for our presenter today, and any advice for him and the other candidates who are appearing for exam this year.
He has done well. Chandramohan sir will be the more.
I'll be a bit critical because he knows theory well. But how to connect this theory into practice, we have to know. Especially first of all, we can't do everything patient asking for. And secondly, when you have such a case, sphincter preservation should be done very cautiously. Because even if you preserve sphincter, the patient is going to have a very miserable life. So, especially lower third cancers, sphincter involvement will be really, really cautious in doing sphincter preservation, and you have to put more effort, and the patient should be counseled well regarding the issues of the sphincter preservation, and then only we should embark on that. Anyway, it's a good performance, past performance, and congratulate you.
We request now Dr. Kevin Raju sir to please deliver his expert talk. I request Dr. Chandramohan sir and Arnab sir to please go through the vast chat box today and contribute with others. And we'll come to you after sir's talk with the final discussion Q&A round. Raju sir, please. Sir.
Thank you to ISO for giving me this opportunity. The considering the enormous strides that are taking place in the field of surgery for rectal cancer, and the radiation oncology and the medical oncology, the newer developments, it would be impossible for me to cover the entire broad within the stipulated time. So this would be a basically very preliminary for primarily to the students. So the important thing is, how do you evaluate your patients? The digital rectal examination is the most important investigation to be conducted in the OPD, wherein you have to localize what is the location of the tumor, the circumference of involvement of the rectal wall, what is the status of the anorectal ring, how far is the tumor from the anal verge, what is the anal tone, whether the tumor is located anteriorly or posteriorly, because all of them have ramifications in our treatment approach. The endo-ultrasonography as a tool is indicated selectively for very early stage disease in order to differentiate T1 versus T2 disease. The CT scan abdomen and chest we have discussed, it is primarily to evaluate the distant metastasis. A contrast-enhanced CT is a good enough modality for evaluating the abdomen, especially the liver, retroperitoneal nodes, any other deposits in the abdomen. A plain CT is good enough for evaluating the pulmonary metastasis. The colonoscopy as an investigative tool is often misused, as is in this case, the first attempt in this particular patient to do a biopsy was colonoscopy. Colonoscopy is not meant for diagnosing rectal cancer. It is for evaluating the colon to identify a synchronous lesions, synchronous malignancy, or a polyps. It is never meant for evaluating the rectum. And if you observe your endoscopist, what they do is they push the scope in, and by the time they push the scope in, they generally cross at least 7 to 8 centimeters into the rectum. So most of the time, if they are not too careful, they will miss the rectal growths. Carcinoembryogenic antigen is a tumor marker which is extensively used to know what is the exact value. And it is important that if the patient has got values of more than 200, it is very highly, it suggests of a very significant volume of disease. Generally, CEA gets elevated only when the patient has got a systemic metastasis. That means the first station is the liver, the second station with the lungs, and sometimes when the patient has got extensive retroperitoneal nodes. A significantly elevated CEA is an indicator that probably the patient has got a systemic metastasis. The MRI is a gold standard of investigation for rectal cancer. Most of the students have the erroneous impression that endorectal coil is needed. It is, that practice has been given up across the globe. A good 1.5 Tesla with proper acquisition sequencing with a thin sectioning is good enough. That's what the Mercury trial has shown. They generally do the MRI sequencing only with 1.5 Tesla. It's important that whenever you do an MRI, as a surgeon, you need to remember this acronym, which will give answers to what we require. The distance means, distance is the disease from the anal verge. The T stands for the tumor stage, the T stage of the disease. The A stands for the anal complex anatomy. The N stands for the nodal disease status. The C stands for the CRM. And the E is for the extramural vascular invasion. All these things have to be assessed by the surgeon if your radiologist is not giving that information. Because without that, you cannot treat your rectal cancer patients properly. A sagittal imaging is done mainly to evaluate what is the location of the tumor, and second, the peritoneal reflection, the anal complex. The coronal section is primarily, its value mainly is to identify the anorectal, the anatomy of the anal complex, wherein you decipher the internal anal sphincter, the intersphincter space, and the external anal sphincter. A mark in this pictorial, you can see here, as you travel down from the cranial end, the mesorectum becomes extremely narrow towards the lower rectum. And therefore, once the tumor invades the muscularis propria, it is likely to get access to the levator ani muscle and the lower rectal cancers. Infiltration of the levator ani occurs quite early in the disease life cycle. The T2 weighted images are the most important sequence in the rectal cancer, and that is where we take the sagittal, coronal, and axial images. In the axial images, you look for the mesorectal fascia involvement. This is the mesorectum. This is the facial sheath surrounding the mesorectum. You also look for what is the depth of involvement of the tumor into the mesorectum, and whether the radial margin is involved or not. If the CRM is more than 2 millimeters, it suggests to that it is CRM is free. If it is less than 1 to 2 millimeters, it is indicative that it is a threatened mesorectum. And if it is less than 1, it implies that the patient has got infiltration of the mesorectum and the patient has to go for some kind of neoadjuvant treatment strategies. Now, this is a patient who has got a distal rectal growth. This is the endoscopic picture. And then you can see here a semi-annular growth with the tumor lying very close to the levator ani and infiltrating the external anal sphincter. Now, this is a few anatomical aspects which needs to be understood by every rectal surgeon. The upper third of the rectum is covered by the peritoneum both anteriorly and laterally, and the mesorectum is quite thick. In the middle part, the peritoneum covers only the anterior part, and the laterally it is free, and the mesorectum, as compared to the upper rectum, is much thinner. In the lower rectum, there is no peritoneal covering anywhere, and the mesorectum is extremely thin. Anteriorly again, as compared to the posterior side, the mesorectum is much thinner. Now, this is again a pictorial depiction of the tumor staging. You can see here a T3, as per the PNM staging system, has got only one. But if you follow the Mercury trial on the ESMO guidelines, they divide them further into 4 subgroups. Patients between 1 to 5, the A and B category, are good risk category, while C and D are poor risk category. A tumor which infiltrates the peritoneal covering in the mid-rectum anteriorly will constitute a T4A disease. And this is depicted by what is called a seagull sign in the T2 weighted images. A T4B implies involvement of the adjacent organs. And in this group of patients, you need to go for aggressive neoadjuvant chemoradiation strategies before you embark on the surgery. As compared to the T stage, the N stage is much more difficult to decipher in the MRI. But these are the recommendations by the radiological societies, where they take into consideration the various characteristics. what is the shape of the tumor, the enhancement pattern, and the border irregularity, and the size of the tumor. If the patient tumor is, the nodal size is less than 5 millimeters in size, you have to have all the three malignant characteristics. If it is more than 9, it is always suggestive of a metastatic disease. The functional imaging, which we are very fond of discussing, have got serious limitations, and they are not meant for routine clinical uses. They do indicate about the response evaluation, which is an indicator that the patient has responded to a treatment, and probably these patients have got a better survival outcomes. In the, as the functional image advances, probably in future, you can measure your the surgical technique and then do a lesser invasive procedures for them. But as of now, it's not in practice. Now, the other important area where the students face a lot of difficulties is the when you read the NCCN guidelines, you then follow a different strategy. While if you follow the European guidelines, they have a different strategy. The difference is because the entire Atlantic, they follow the TNM staging system, a more a clinical oriented, while the Euro, they follow the MRI scanning, which is a much superior because they subgroup the patients into good risk, poor risk, and uglier. And based upon the risk stratification, surgery is carried out. Now, this is an illustration wherein you can see here in TNM staging, in stage 3 is extremely heterogeneous. There are several subgroup of patients who do very well, while the more other groups that do pretty poor, even in stage 3. And the AJCC staging system doesn't include the CRM stage or the extramural vascular invasion, which is a predictor of systemic metastasis and systemic failure. Now, this is an interesting slide to show you the limitations of the anatomical staging. This there on the far right, you can see this is a patient who got a stage 1 disease, the tumor confined to the wall, but the patient has got an extramural vascular invasion with involvement of the mesorectal fascia. So this becomes a CRM positive. So it will be a very high risk group of patient, though he's a stage 1 disease. So this patient ideally should undergo an extensive neoadjuvant chemo radiation treatment, followed by, depending upon the response, you may have to go up to an ELAP technique. While, though it is a stage 1 disease as per the TNM staging system. On the far left, you can see here the patient has got an extensive growth in the mid and lower rectum, deeply infiltrating, more than 15 millimeters in size, and very close to the mesorectum. Again, this is a stage 2 disease, a T3 and 0, but because of the certain parameters that are adverse, the CRM is positive and the EMY is positive, this patient ideally should undergo, again, a long-term chemo radiation treatment, followed by, if needed, a chemotherapy, and then carry out an elaborate surgery sometime beyond TME. In the middle, you can see here a patient who has got a straightforward T3N1 disease. The tumor has got CRM is negative. If you go by the conventional TNM staging, he falls into the T3N1, that means a stage 3 disease. The patient who should go for a chemo radiation. While if you follow the European standards, which is based upon the MRI stratification, he will fall into a good risk category. There is no need for any chemo radiation. The patient goes for upfront TME. There is no rule for any chemo, no rule for any radiation treatment. So these are some of the limitations which exemplify the deficits of the TNM staging. So the modern staging should include an elaborate, apart from the T stage and the nodal stage, you need to give information about the depth of invasion of the mesorectum, whether the mesorectal fascia is involved or not, whether the circumferential dissection margin is positive or not, and whether the patient has got extramural vascular invasion. The extramural vascular invasion is an indicator of a systemic failure, so the patient should receive adequate doses of chemo radiation treatment prior to any surgical intervention. So this is an example of a patient who will fall into the this patient, for example, a T2, T3 disease, less than 5 millimeter, a low rectal cancer, but you have a CRM is negative, and there is no invasion of the major rectum as per the ESMO guidelines. It will fall into the intermediate risk, and these group of patients can safely undergo a total mesorectal excision with a local recurrence rate of less than 5%. So these are the ESMO guidelines, and you can see here what our colleague has presented, what Pardo has presented, was a patient who has got a T3A or B low rectal cancer. The levator RNA was free. He could undergo a TME in selected group of patients. Otherwise, the patient should undergo a short course chemo radiation radiation or a chemo radiation treatment, depending upon the institutional preference and the expertise. A word about the TME. The TME has changed radically the way we are approaching our rectal cancers. Prior to the TME era, we used to do a blunt dissection using our fingers and used to thrust behind the rectum and go up to the pelvis in one sweeping movement and leaving a lot of residual disease behind. The Heald has described this technique wherein dissection is carried out along the embryogenic fusion lines between the parietal and visceral layers of the fascia. We encompass the entire mesorectum as a group, including all the lymph nodes, by preserving the autonomic nerves. I won't go into this. Every one of us know about these two pictorial depictions. In upper rectal growths, where the mesorectum is complete, in the upper rectal growths, we need to keep in mind that the mucosal spread of rectal cancer is only about for 1 to 2 centimeters, while the radial spread of the disease is up to 4 centimeters. So whenever you are doing a rectal surgery, the rectal mucosal margin could be around 2 centimeters, but at least a 5 centimeters of mesorectum has to be resected. So for upper rectal cancer, you can carry out what is called a partial mesorectal excision, while for the mid and low rectal, it has to be a total mesorectal excision. The distal rectal cancers have got certain anatomical peculiarities which make them vulnerable to have high risk of local recurrence. The most important is it doesn't have the peritoneal covering. The mesorectum is extremely thin and therefore it doesn't have the cushion. The other technical problem for the low rectal is the narrow pelvis, especially the males. So that makes the carrying out the surgery in this area extremely difficult. So the radial margins of resection are likely to be positive in a large number of distal rectal cancer unless you are an expert in the field. The mesorectal excision is one surgery in the entire field of surgical oncology which has shown, based upon randomized studies, that a surgical technique changes the outcome. These are the comparison of the Stockholm 1 and 2 and combined with the TME. And you can see here, the local recurrence rates are about 8 to 9% less with the TME approach. The overall survival rates are also significantly better, about 6 to 7% better by adopting a new surgical technique called TME. So that's why we talk so much about the TME. The adjuvant radiation treatment, if you keep in mind the data that is available, doesn't change the survival outcomes. But the TME as a surgery, if you do it properly, improve the survival outcomes. But it's very important to know what is a good TME. So the pathologist described this, whether the surgery has been carried out in the mesorectal plane. So this is the patient who has got a growth. All around, there is a good covering of the mesorectum, both anteriorly, laterally, and posteriorly. This is the ideal surgery that we have to carry out for rectal surgery. The next, the intramesorectal plane, or it is a plane of resection is the muscularis propria. When you do it is surgery in the muscularis propria, you are cutting through the tumor, so it is an either an R1 or an R2 disease, which should never be attempted. Now, this is a data obtained from one of the earliest slides from the publications from the one of the text from the books, where they have analyzed what is the local recurrence rates and what is responsible for the local recurrence. This is from the Sweden, who are pioneers in the total major rectal excision. In about 90 patients, it has been found that the local recurrences are due to persistent mesorectum in spite of so-called total mesorectal excision. The commonest cause of an anastomotic recurrence is likely to be inadequate mesorectal clearance. So we have to keep in mind that even in expert hands, they may be doing inadequate job. The reasons for the local recurrence in the lateral cancer is partly if you don't administer radiation treatment in indicated patients. The others are inadequate addressal of the circumferential margin, inadequate addressal of the distal mucosal margin, and third is the incomplete mesorectal excision. All these parameters are to be carried out properly by the surgeon. So the most important prognostic factor in rectal cancer in terms of local recurrence is how well the surgery has been carried out. That means as an individual surgeon, you are responsible for the inadequacies of the surgical treatment. Now, this is a ruler classification of the distal rectal cancer, how to approach the distal rectal cancers. They classified them into type 1, 2, 3, 4. If the patient has got what is called a supraanal tumor, just about 1 to 2 centimeters above the sphincter complex, the treatment would be an ultra-low anteroresection with 1 to 2 centimeters margin and do a colonal anastomosis, either stable or from below, or sometimes we do what is called an abdominal sacral approach because it gives a visual inspection of your anatomy and direct suturing of the rectal wall. The type 2 is a tumor which is abutting the anal complex. The distal margin is very close to the anal complex. And in this group of patients, you may have to carry out what is called a partial intersphincter resection. While the intra-anal tumor is a tumor which has directly infiltrated the internal anal sphincter. And in this group of patients, an intersphincter plane of resection would be a reasonable option. But mind that, especially whenever you're embarking on this intersphincter resection, you need to be extremely careful that the patient has got a good functioning capacity and they should be ready for what is called low anteroresection syndrome, which occurs in anywhere between 50 to 70% of the patients. Once the tumor has infiltrated the external anal complex, the external anal sphincter, there is no other option. The patient has to go for abdominal perineal excision of various types. The radiation does play an important role in reducing the local recurrence, and the preoperative radiation does reduce the recurrence by about close to around 50%. And these are the various studies which have established the role of the preoperative radiation. Now, these are the landmark trials which have been carried out to defining the role of each one of the approaches, be it the short course or the long course radiation treatment. In the entire Europe, general approach is to go for short course radiation treatment. In the North American, it is primarily long course of chemo radiation treatment. But slowly in some centers in the West, also in the West implying the Atlantic area also, they're veering towards the short course treatment. We need to understand a few differences between the approaches. A short course treatment is generally given over a period of about 5 days, five into five grays in over 5 days. And then you operate these patients anywhere between 10 to 15 days. That means 3 days after the completion to the complete prior to the 15 days. In terms of oncological outcomes, that means the local recurrence rates, the distant metastasis rates, and the overall survival rate, there is no differences whether it is a short course or long course chemoradiation treatment. The acute toxicity is much worse in the long course treatment, while the long-term side effects are much more with the short course because of the fractionation doses is much higher. The advantages of the short course treatment is the duration is shorter. So the logistically, as for example, presently in the COVID era, this would be much more easier for much more patient friendly. While if you want to achieve what I would say downstage the disease and you have to achieve an archer resection, personal choice would be to go for a long course chemo radiation treatment. But some centers in the West following the Rapido trial are adopting the strategy of giving a short course radiation treatment followed by chemotherapy and then carry out the surgery in a delayed fashion. Now, in the recent past, there is a lot of talk about the total neoadjuvant treatment. The total neoadjuvant treatment by definition implies administering the entire course of the neoadjuvant chemotherapy upfront so that there is a downstaging of the disease, there is an earlier addressal of the metastatic foci, there is likely to be an increased organ preservation, and another advantage is the early ileostomy reversal. But we have to keep in mind a total neoadjuvant treatment consisting of administering the entire chemotherapy upfront alone, we don't have any randomized studies. There are studies where they're combined with chemotherapy, is combined with the short course radiation treatment, as is the Rapido trial, or the chemo radiation protocols as followed by the OKRA trial and one German trial. These trials show that both the OKRA trial and the German trial shows that radiation is an essential integral component in order to have a good local control. And the distant metastasis is a hypothetical question because as yet there is no proof that the TNT eliminates the distant metastasis. The other reason why the people are pushing the TNT is because large number of rectal cancer patients who undergo surgery, who otherwise warrant chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy, they never receive the chemotherapy for several reasons. Either they are not explained properly, or your belief that chemotherapy doesn't work, and sometimes because of the interruptions or delays. Now, this is the induction treatment, which is the most of the people nowadays are pushing, is not based upon enough evidence. For various subsites in the entire body, be it for the head and neck, for the esophagus, and other subsites, the induction treatment alone as a strategy has failed to establish its superiority. But for rectal cancers, we have to wait the long-term results. So in fact, in the Journal of Clinical Oncology, in the recent editorial, says that as a strategy, this should be confined to clinical trials alone. We are not questioning the strategy of adopting a short course radiation treatment followed with a neoadjuvant chemotherapy for advanced disease, a T4N2 disease that is following the Rapido protocol, where radiation is an integral component. The chemo alone is never a good strategy for a disease which is primarily a local problem. The last couple of slides to exemplify the variations in the NCCN guidelines versus the ESMO guidelines. Most of the NCCN guidelines, they suggest for T3 and T4 disease that the patient has to go for either chemotherapy followed by chemo radiation prior to surgery or a chemo radiation followed by surgery. But if you follow the ESMO guidelines, they stratify these group of patients into very early disease, and early disease, intermediate disease, locally advanced disease, and advanced disease. For intermediate disease, which constitutes a significant number of our patients, in a significant patients, especially the upper rectal cancers, mid-rectal T3A and B, as long as the mesorectal fascia is clear, they don't require chemotherapy or radiation upfront. A good TME is a viable option. For patient who has got a more advanced disease, that means a T3C or D mid-rectum, or patients who have got very low rectal disease, levators are not threatened, mesorectal fascia is clear with a nodal disease. In these group of patients, the ESMO proposes a short course radiation treatment followed by a mesorectal excision. In a selected subgroup of patients, provided the patient understands the limitations of the wait and watch policy, one can offer them in a patients who have got a complete clinical response, an observation strategy. For patients who have got a CRM positivity, or patients who have got sphincter involvement, patients who have got a T4B disease, or patients who have got lateral nodal disease, they have to undergo a long course chemo radiation treatment. And later on, depending upon the response to the treatment, one can carry out either a total mesorectal excision or sometimes even a surgery beyond the TME. So wait and watch approach is initially proposed by the Habergama group. And this lady has done a pioneering work. For a long time, she has been ridiculed when she was offered this treatment to her patients. But increasingly across the globe, in a selected group of patients, especially patients who have got T2 or T3 disease, who got excellent response based upon clinical radiological grounds, they can be kept under wait and watch policy, provided the patient understands the limitations. More recently, we have data from the Sloan Kettering Center where they approach, they provide what is called a non-operative management for a selected group of patients who develop a complete CR based upon the imaging clinical and and the endoscopic picture. In those group of patients, a non-operative management can be offered extremely selectively, knowing fully well the various limitations of the treatment. These are just a couple of slides to show what will happen if the does the local recurrences is salvageable in rectal cancers. The local recurrences in rectal cancers have been classified into various groups. The type 1 is an anastomotic stricture, type 1A. A perineal recurrence will constitute 1B. Involvement of the adjacent organs will constitute the 1C. Most of these recurrences or because of inadequate mesorectal clearance. As long as it is an anastomotic recurrence alone, one can go for a supralevator anterior exaggeration or what is called a low anterior Hartmann procedure. For patients who have got a perineal resection, you may have to do an extensive surgical procedure utilizing resection with various flaps. Involvement of the adjacent organ like bladder may require an exaggeration. Patient where the tumor is infiltrated the sacrum will fall into what is called a type 3 recurrence pattern. And these group of patients, they need to undergo a partial sacrectomy. While the upper sacrectomy is a technically challenging and most of the time it's not feasible because the patient has got advanced disease. A type 2 local recurrence pattern implies this is a patient who has got a disease primarily laterally. And this is primarily because of inadequate addressal of the lateral pelvic nodes in mid and low rectal cancers. So in patients, as Pardo has alluded to, the recent trial from the Western Center, where they have accepted that the lateral lymph node clearance has got some role to play. It has been pushed by the Japanese for a long time. Slowly, we are getting data from the West also, where in highly selected group of patients, following chemo radiation, if we have a persistent disease where the lateral lymph node is more than 7 millimeter in short axis, you have to carry out lateral lymph node dissection. If the patient has got isolated vessel involvement, You can control the vessel more cranially, putting a clamp here or either on the iota or on the iliac vessel and do a resection anastomosis. While involvement of the sciatic nerve, generally we don't offer surgery, but there are a few case reports where even a sciatic nerve has been excised. So local recurrences in rectal cancer is a domain of the surgical oncologist, wherein in certain selected subgroup of patients, the patient may need either a chemotherapy or radiation treatment, but unless you do a surgical clearance, salvage is not feasible. To conclude, I would say for rectal cancer, the MRI is the central point based on which your entire decision making of management depends upon, whether the patient goes for a surgery or it is a short course treatment or a long course treatment. TME alone is good enough for most of the situations, but in a selected group of patients, they have to go for either a short course radiation treatment or a long course chemo radiation treatment. The TNT as a tool, though it is extremely popular, is being discussed. It has to be ratified by a future prospective studies. We have to wait the long-term study results, then only we have to use it for individual clinical practice. Wait and watch is an option which has to be discussed with your patients, though we don't have any randomized studies. Newer techniques like minimally invasive surgery, TACMI, and NOSES are to be done in expert centers depending upon the feasibility and availability of expertise. Thank you.
Thank you, Raju sir, for that comprehensive and superb talk. For our last section for the day, this includes some curated questions that we have selected for our panelists today. We've included names of the experts we want to direct these questions to, but however, the remaining examiners are welcome to put their opinion also. Our first question is, as we heard from Raju sir, about the differences between the two approaches through NCCN and ESMO. Chandramohan sir, how should we extrapolate these guidelines to our MDTs, and should we pick a side or should we titrate?
I understand the question. That's a very, very tricky question. Actually, each MDT has to decide how to manage. And from the discussion so far and from the literature, we know that, you know, mostly the debates comes over whether you go for a long course or for short course. And if you look at the quality of surgery, I think you will vouch for European or UK or Netherlands, where they popularize TME. And we don't, and if you consider imaging also, I think commendable work has come from Europe, not from US. So if I emulate and do a quality surgery, I look at Europe. If I want to use MRI scan and get better decisions, I will of course look at UK and for Pelican Blue. But regarding the use of long course versus short course, I think conventionally most Indian centers are biased towards US guidelines. And the reason being, most of our cases are advanced. I think it itself demands a sphincter saving and a downstaging. So it will go for a NCCN kind of advices. So it's a mixed match thing. But again, please understand that even in German trial, there is no survival advantage in CTRT versus upfront surgery. So if some surgeon will like to classify the tumor according to T3ABC and like to do a surgery for the early cancers, they are perfectly free to do that because survival is not going to change much. And I also tried to bring in, where are you stopping with European or US? Why can't you bring in the Japanese guidelines as well? So where they insist on the margin, like they want always 5 centimeter margin approximately. They want pelvic node dissections to be done when the involved nodes are there after RT. So it's a mix and match, and we have to select each scenario and each protocol according to the particular patients. And I think the since we don't have any guidelines, it gives you ample opportunity to grab any of these guidelines and practice according to our conveniences. So it's no straight answer for this question. I think we have to match everything. Thank you.
Sir, as far as adjuvant chemotherapy is concerned?
Adjuvant, I think if there is disease, we should believe that in a case which is given neoadjuvant protocol, we should believe that the neoadjuvant has suppressed it and we considered it as involved and continue with adjuvant treatment. Unless you are giving total neoadjuvant treatment at the beginning.
Yeah, yeah. Responses from Raju sir and Arnab sir?
It is the same as I agree with Chandramohan sir, whatever he has said.
We go to our second question to Dr. K.V. and Raju sir. Sir, you elucidated the indications, but outside TNT, what are your indications for short course RT as of today?
Yeah, more often for patients who present to me with a metastatic disease, with a local disease, when it is likely to be symptomatic, we offer them a short course radiation treatment, treat the systemically, and then carry out a surgical resection if it's amenable. Otherwise, continue the systemic treatment.
And outside that approach, sir, outside TNT in a non-metastatic setting?
Outside, practically our experience, only recently we have a handful of patients with following the Rapido trial for locally advanced disease T4N2 distal rectal cancer, where the volume is significantly high. In those group of patients, we are doing the short course.
No. Yeah, I think it's correct. When you want to do surgery fast, I think you have to go for short course because you can't delay for chemotherapy further. Otherwise, I think by and large, long course is okay. And maybe COVID is an indication for short course because it will limit
yes.
the...
Yes, my radiation oncologists are these days pay us for doing a short course radiotherapy because in COVID situation, it is difficult for the patients to come here. Only thing is, maybe, I don't know what is your take, sir. If we can delay the surgery after the short course by good about 4 to 5 weeks, do you think the pelvic, the complications, the local complications reduce?
Yes, yes. Actually, short course radiotherapy is having complications, post-op complications and so post-op complications high. So if you delay surgery, it will reduce. And I think after COVID, it's our standard practice to give short course and delay.
Yes.
Our third question is to Dr. Arnab, sir. So we discussed this in short during discussion. Dead space in the pelvis during APEs and LAPs. When and how do you fill it, sir? What's your approach?
I was lucky not to get these kind of patients too much in my life, in my very small life. I must say that I'm lucky. Most of my APE patients, I close primarily. I've got only 3 to 4 patients where I took the help of my reconstructive team and they have done a local flap. So I'm lucky that and really speaking, I have not done too much of ELAP, maybe 1 or 2. At that time I took, in case of APE, I could manage to close it primarily till now. And with ELAP, I took the help of my reconstructive team.
I think we have a fair experience with the ELAP technique. And whenever you do the ELAP, you need to fill it up. You can use the various flaps like vertical rectus abdominis myocutaneous flap or a gluteus flap or sometimes a latissimus medusae or sometimes even a ALT flap. And in the biomeshes have been described in the European setup, but it is extremely expensive using the cellular dermal matrix. So we don't use it. Some people use what is called the breast silicon implants, and which then subsequently deflate it later. These are the various techniques, but by and large, we have used the flap technique only. We don't have experience with the ACD or with the silicon processes.
Ramon, sir, omentum uterus
use biomesh. I know it's expensive, but use.
Next question to Chandramohan, sir. Sir, left colic artery, how often does it limit the reach of the proximal loop in ultra-LARs?
Very simple answer. Very rarely it limits. And if it limits, just ligate it. Nothing happens.
Next question to Raju, sir. Sir, when should we close the diversion ileostomy if the patient is on adjuvant chemotherapy? And is there any role of distal loop washes or enema training in these patients who have late closures?
Now, it depends upon, there are two strategies here. One is to early closure, where you close in about within 3 to 4 weeks after the ileostomy has been done, and then you start your chemotherapy. The other is to wait for long. But generally, in my practice, to start early closure, it doesn't change the outcomes. But a large number of people, they delayed quite late. And in those group of patients, you may have to wait till the completion of the chemotherapy. Either strategy is reasonable. But the only thing is the inconvenience to the patient with the prolonged ileostomy back. And as for the enema training or the distal loop washes, we hardly use it.
Arnab sir, would you agree that it should be either before chemo and after chemo, never in between?
Yes, I also agree.
Chandramohan sir.
Yeah, I slightly disagree because I don't know. The patients came very late after chemo. So the medical oncologist always press for chemotherapy very fast, and our logistic doesn't allow a fast closure. And even if you want to do a fast closure, you have to wait at least 3 months. So I think the ideal thing for me should to start chemotherapy and have a 2 or 3 cycles and close it. But it's not practical always.
Srajan, I agree with Chandramohan also. I accept his argument. It all depends upon the personal choice and the availability and the practice in our center. I don't think it will make any material difference in terms of the outcomes.
Next question is to Dr. Arnab, sir. Rectal cancer with liver metastasis, sir, is total neoadjuvant treatment now the uniform recommendation, or would you choose some patients for upfront surgery?
Yes, if it is upfront resectable, I think it should be resected. Because the problem with the chemotherapy, what I found out, that if you give chemotherapy and the liver lesion disappears, then what you do? Either a gastrectomy or an anatomical liver resection of a right hemihepatectomy or a hepatectomy or a left. So that's why it is probably better, or you put some markers which are not available easily in the market. So it is better if it can be resected first. And there is, of course, the problem of cash. Also, it is no less. So if it is upfront resectable, if we can resect it and then start the chemotherapy. Only catch is that you have to start the chemotherapy within 6 weeks. You have to also remember that. Because other than if you miss that 6 weeks, then the effect of the chemotherapy goes within that aim. I would like to know from Chandramohan sir and Raju sir both.
Yeah, so I think it's not a very clear-cut answer for this question because of two reasons. Number one, I like to give chemotherapy for the patient without much delay because liver metastasis is going to progress. At the same time, I also don't like to the liver metastasis disappear. So it's a tricky situation. It also depends upon how big surgery you are going to do for rectal cancer. And so why can't, if you have only a upper rectal cancer and a single liver metastasis, there is no harm in going ahead and doing upfront surgery and finish up and then continue with adjuvant treatment. At the same time, if this rectal surgery is a bit complex, then I have like to stage it do the rectal part first or liver part first. And it's always very, very lot of permutation combinations are available. There is no straightforward answer for this. And TNT is definitely a new modality which is going to come up. I don't think we are not mature enough to recommend it as a uniform consensus for across practices.
So, Sajan, I think TNT cannot be a uniform recommendation as of now. In a selected group of patients, we can go for chemotherapy upfront, while in others, if it is resectable, surgery can be an option. While in other group of patients, you go for a strategy wherein you can consider short course radiation plus chemotherapy, and then access the liver first. So you have various options. We cannot have one option for here. And then the TNT is not the uniform recommendation.
Excellent, sir. For completion's sake, our next question to Chandramohan, sir. Room for CRS HIPEC in peritoneal mets, sir?
Yeah, there is definitely a room, but the room should not be always open. So we have to just judiciously see that, whether the other parameters, the tumor biology is not bad, then of course we can consider with the limited peritoneal disease. And please remember that we are getting a lot of evidences lately against the role of HIPEC in colorectal cancer. So it should be judiciously chosen and done. If it is a secretory cancer, it is a straight away no. So it's a difficult decision, but the HIPEC has a role.
Our last question to Dr. Raju, sir. Acute obstruction with rectal cancer, sir, to go with colostomy or ileostomy?
Okay, I think it would depend upon what is the disease burden and what your intent of the treatment is, and whether the patient has got a closed loop obstruction or an open loop obstruction. So based on the parameters, if the patient has got a short disease span and we are not planning to go for a corrective surgery, I may go for a colostomy, because that will make the job easier for the patient in terms of the effluent is less, so management of the bag is easier. But on the other hand, if the patient is on a routine basis, I would go for an ileostomy. But if somebody has got a closed loop obstruction, we need to be established clearly that in those group of patients, probably again, I'll go for a colostomy.
Anup, sir, Chandramohan, sir.
It depends upon are we going to manage it later. And if it's a scenario with multiple liver metastasis and very advanced rectal cancer, I think I'll end up with an end sigmoid colostomy so that the patient can safely go for palliation. But otherwise, if you're planning a resection later on, I think anything is acceptable. You can do a colostomy and ileostomy, and ileostomy is good enough.
Yes, me too.
So that's all from our side here. I thank Dr. Chandramohan, sir, Arnab, sir, and Raju, sir, for patiently answering our questions. I request Dr. Sharad Desai, sir, now to start the closing session and give his vote of thanks.
Yeah, good evening, everybody. I think Srijan, today the chat box was, loaded with a lot of traffic. You must have had a lot of difficulty trying to choose the questions. And well done, brother. You have done a good job, especially today. Dr. Raju, sir, thank you for an excellent presentation. As I have always known you, actually, Dr. Raju, sir, is a very silent and very quiet personality. He left the institute just before I joined. And I know from the nurses used to tell me that there was one person called Dr. Raju, who used to be very silent, but he was a tanker of knowledge. And they used to say that he was very active in the operation theater also. So students, do not get fooled by the quietness of an examiner. Some people are really brilliant.
Thank you, sir.
I also thank Dr. Arnab, sir, and Dr. Chandramohan for the participation. We are really, you have kept the whole session very intriguing, and it was very pleasant today. Our next meeting is on 6th May, the first Friday, and please also just make a note. I also thank Dr. Sarangi, sir, for the conduct of the whole meeting for tonight. And I finally thank the organizers, Basoka Tarakam Indo-American Institute, Dr. Subramanya Rao and Dr. Srijan, for all their efforts. And I also thank the students for keeping on coming to these sessions, and who keep on encouraging us to hold the sessions and improve upon them better and better. From my side, I thank the ISO team led by Dr. Arnab Gupta. And we will see you again the next after fortnight next on 6th May. So goodbye, everybody.
Thank you, Sharad. Before everybody signs off, thank you from my side.
Thank you, ISO.
I'm really grateful to the Academic Council, the examiners. Parsha, I think I don't really blame him. He had a very short notice. Somebody else was supposed to present, and he's only in the second year. I'm sure he will do well, better.
He's done a good job.
He's done a good job. I'm sure he can do better. And thank you once again. We look forward to the next PG masterclass. And meanwhile, I request once again, please everybody become members of ISO. Let's be a part of this big society. Thank you very much.
Thank
Have
you.
A wonderful day of evening. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, everyone, and stay safe.
Good job.